morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Thank you to the Bell Choir for that beautiful intro. And Richard, yours was beautiful too, if not even more relatable with that. But it's always great to be in worship together. All of you in the sanctuary, all of those who are watching on our church website, what a gift it is to be able to gather like this each Sunday to celebrate our faith, to celebrate the light and love of God and Christ in our lives. As we get started each week, I always like to give an opportunity for anyone who is new, if this is your first time or if this has been, it's been a long time, and you feel like you want to raise your hand and let us know who you are and even how you discovered, how you found your way up the hill. This is a great opportunity to do that. No pressure, but we just love to see if we have new folks so we can get to know you, because after worship, we have coffee hour. And we can kind of have some chance to get to know you a little bit better. Yes, Steve. Hi.
My daughter Jennifer is here visiting Colorado.
Oh, wonderful. Well, welcome, Jennifer. What part of Colorado are you visiting from?
Denver.
Okay, nice. Yeah, lived there for 4 years, not in Denver, but love Colorado. So welcome. Glad to have you here. Anyone else? Well, one and all are welcome, whether it's your first time here or you've been coming here your entire life. What we say every Sunday as a reminder and as a call, a vision for who we are and who we aim to be. Whoever you are on the journey of life or faith, whoever you love, whatever you've done, whatever your politics are, all the different categories dissolve here. You are welcome as you are, and the fabric of Christ's love is knitted more strongly because you are here today. And as a testimony to that unity we share, the community we share in Christ, I'd like to invite you now to take a few moments to stand and greet your neighbor. I was thinking about it. It's been since the play that we've had a children's conversation, and I'm still feeling so excited about what you all were able to do in that play. And it was so great. But today, to start, I wanted to just give you a few questions and see if you could help me with the answers. Okay? The first one is this. You have only one match. You enter a dark room. There's a candle, newspaper, and some kindling. Which do you light first?
You say?
The candle.
No. You have a guess?
Newspaper.
No.
The candle.
No. The match.
The match. Oh, gotcha. Okay. How about this one? You light the match first. Okay. All right. So there are six apples. You take away four. How many do you have?
You still have six because you still have the cores of the apple.
Oh, I didn't actually talk about eating them, but I guess that's, I like the creativity. Now, see, I got you thinking.
You still have six.
Wait.
Okay, you have, there are six apples. You take away four. How many do you have? You have four.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Yeah, that's all. You have four. But there are six apples left, but you have four. Okay. How about this one? Tommy's mom has three children. Okay? The youngest, the first one, is named Penny. I'm holding a penny. The second one is named Nick. What's the third one named?
Wait.
I heard answers from the peanut gallery. People are excited. They like riddles. Amber?
Dime?
I see. I held that up to trick you. Jericho?
Quarter?
Timmy or whatever?
Yeah, it's Tommy.
Tommy.
Remember, I started by saying Tommy's mom has three children. Penny, Nick, and Tommy. Okay. I know. They're called trick questions, sometimes called riddles. We used to do this for bedtime stories. But anyway, they can be really fun. But they can also be kind of frustrating because they make you feel, I don't know, they can make you feel a little foolish or like, oh, how could I have missed that? And nobody likes to feel that way. Our story from the Bible today is about a time where there were some people that came up to Jesus and thought they were so smart and they wanted to trick him. So they asked him what we call a trick question. And their trick question was, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? And they said it exactly in that accent. Now, why would that be a trick question? Well, here's the thing. Jesus, if he says, oh, absolutely, they should pay taxes to Caesar, a lot of his Jewish friends that didn't like Rome because they came and took over everything, they didn't think it was fair to pay taxes to Rome, so they would have been very mad at Jesus for saying something like that. So that wouldn't have worked. But if Jesus said, oh, absolutely not, do not pay your taxes to Rome, the Roman soldiers who were standing nearby would have come and said, sir, please come with us. And they would have arrested him and maybe done something worse. So what did Jesus do?
Nothing.
He didn't do nothing. He said, he asked the people who were trying to trap him. He said, can you give me a Roman coin, please? And they did. Now, you may have noticed, or you may just know, that when you look at our coins, what are something that every coin and really every piece of currency has on it? Wyatt?
A dude.
Okay. We don't call them a dude. It's actually one of our former...
A president.
A very good answer, Jericho. And I'll give you partial credit, Wyatt. But anyway, there's there. But yes, so we have presidents on our currency. And so that is something that, you know, we have. And in Rome, they had the same thing. In fact, if you have your, if someone holds up their bulletin, I put a picture of what their Roman currency looked like. That's a picture of Caesar on it. Okay? So Jesus, after he asked them for the coin, says, okay, well, whose picture is this on their coin? And they say, oh, well, that's Caesar. And Jesus very smartly says to them, fine, then give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God.
Smart.
It is really smart. And so when we look at our American currency, all of this has pictures of presidents or dudes on them, and they say United States of America. So really, this currency, while it belongs to us, it also belongs, it's part of what we use to pay, say, taxes to our government. So that's what we give to pay. That's fine. Some people don't like it very much, but it's what we do. It's part of the contract that we have here. But Jesus also said, give to God what belongs to God. What do you think he means by that? What has the image of God on it?
Dee, 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 dee.
I could keep going. What has the image of God on it? Maybe it's a trick question. Again. How about if I ask it this way? Who has the image of God on them?
All of us.
Amen. Yes. Do you remember the story in creation that says God created all that is, and God created people in the image of God, the image and likeness of God? That means if we're all created in that image, we belong to God. So what does it mean then to give ourselves back to God? How do we do that? You don't know? What do you think? Some ideas.
Respect Him.
Respect God. Very good. Yep, that's one way. And that's partly what we do in church. We respect God by showing praise. We sing songs. We pray. We talk like this. What are other ways we give ourselves? Yeah, so worship. What other ways do we give ourselves to God? It's stuff that you do all the time, but sometimes we don't think about it. Pray? Absolutely. What are other things? There are so many. When we love our neighbor, when we give something out of what we have for someone else, when we're kind to our siblings. I know, it's very rare. But no, these types of things are ways that we give ourselves back to God. So the challenge that you have and that we all have is, how can I think of more ways to keep giving myself back to God? Let's say a prayer together. God, thank you for making us in your image. Help us to remember that we belong to you, and help us to look for more creative ways to give ourselves back to you and to each other in your love. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for coming down. Have fun in church school. This point of the worship is an opportunity to share some of the prayer concerns, and so some of them have been filled out, and I will share some others that have been given to me prior to worship. So please join me in a spirit of prayerful listening. God, we start our prayers this morning by lifting prayers of comfort and clarity and direction and healing for Julia as she continues to navigate the care for her seizures, and also for Susie, as she is the primary caregiver and the rock and has been searching in every way and at all times for whatever care can be provided, and is such a fierce advocate for Julia. But we pray for both of them as they walk through this trying time of health. We also continue to pray for baby Finnick, who has been on a roller coaster ride, but is improving in terms of his health from a recent surgery. So we pray that continues and that his best outcome may be at hand. Barbara Hollitz asks for prayers for her brother, Douglas Braun, who is in the hospital currently for lung problems. May Douglas receive the care that he needs, and may the doctors be able to see clearly through a path for his well-being and health. Chris offers prayers for someone going through cancer treatment right now. We pray for them, those ones that she holds dear, and we pray for those church members and friends who are also on the walk, the journey, the trying, the difficult place of being in cancer treatment right now. May all of those who are on this walk know that they are not alone. May they find strength to help get through, and may their best outcome also be at hand. As we continue our prayer time, I offer an opportunity for anyone in the congregation to call out a joy or a concern or a name as we hold a space of silence. And then after that, I will close us with a pastoral prayer and we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. God, on this beautiful Sabbath day, we thank you for the chance to be here together, to center ourselves on the things that matter most. While we are here, we also know that this is a season of a lot of activity, a lot of movement. And many of us may be feeling that activity and movement within our bodies and minds right now. We ask for the grace and for the courage to let that go for the time being and to find our way to be here. Help to root us down into this place, God, that we might be present to receive not only your spirit, but to receive a sense of connection that is so often missing in our world. May this body of Christ be a source and a beacon of light and love, even as it simply gathers here in your name. God, help us to walk in our daily lives the way that you showed us through Jesus, even as we pray using the words he taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please remain seated and join me in the responsive prayer on the back. Your portion is the bold. Caesar, did you create the stars? Hurl them to the reaches of the universe? Did you issue rules that keep the planets in place? Can you make blood course through our veins? Or craft an otter or a moonflower? Then keep your coins. They can't buy what we need. God, it is your face we see in our world, our very selves, our breath, and love. We owe every single thing to you. Claim it all. Claim us. Take us as your own and send us in your love.
We'll stand and sing our opening hymn, number 39, under blue hymnal, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Thank you. Our reading today is taken from the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible. It's in Matthew 22, verses 15 through 22. The question about paying taxes. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality." Sorry. "Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. May God bless this reading and our understanding.
Please be with me in a spirit of prayer. God, may your spirit find its way through my words and into the hearts and minds of people who are perceiving them. May what is shared here nourish us in the moment and also plant seeds for reflection and growth and change for the betterment and the blessing of your world. In and with Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Being that it's Christ the King Sunday, I find it tempting to preach a sermon about the separation of church and state, to give the theological underpinnings for the idea as well as the political ones. But then I decided I wanted you to stay awake. But I have to say, it kind of spoke to me to talk about that topic because, you know, we've all seen a surge in recent years in the U.S., the rise of Christian nationalism, which in many ways is the opposite of the separation of church and state. And at first blush, the reading that Steve just read seems to be about the separation of church and state, so maybe that is a good way to approach it. But the truth is, when you get a little bit more close to the story, when you get in there, it becomes clear that this is more about the church and state uniting together to try and trap Jesus. That's what the story focuses on. So we have the Pharisees, who are the religious leaders of the day, and then we have this group called the Herodians, which are politicians in their own right. And neither of those groups like each other, okay? But they both see Jesus as a threat, so they unite in this effort to get him out of their way, whatever means necessary. So really, the text is not so much focused on the separation of church and state, but it shows us what happens when the leaders of church and state combine their powers. In our world, in our lifetimes, certainly recently, we have seen what can be wrought when the church and the state combine their powers. Too many times in recent years, Christian symbols, particularly the cross, have been appropriated to inspire violence, to encourage insurrection, even to support notions of war. seems so obvious, but given that, it must be said clearly. The cross of Jesus is never about promoting violence. Instead, it's God's proclamation that this myth we have of redemptive violence is over. It's gone. The cross symbolizes God giving God's very self in love to the world. And that it's the message that love can never be stopped or put down, no matter what the intention is. So yes, it does still remain tempting to kind of try to preach that sermon about, you know, separation of church and state. But I will also admit this. I'm tempted to preach a simpler, milder sermon as well. I mean, it would be a legitimate interpretation of the text to say that what Matthew is having Jesus say is basically, all right, pay your taxes and serve Jesus. Serve God. Okay? That would be legit. And I've preached that sermon before. Wasn't very good. And I also know it's almost Thanksgiving. And some of us are about to face challenging or difficult conversations over the coming days. And maybe, you know, the sermon doesn't need to add to that. So let's just keep it light, huh? Well, we often do want that. Or we think we do. I had a friend back in Massachusetts whose church, he just started at a church, and they had this list of expectations for him. And they insisted that he keep his sermons short and light. So they basically said, we want it 10 minutes or less. It's got to have a joke of some sort, which, whatever. But then the last part was something along the lines of, don't preach on anything that's politically divisive. Whatever that means. So he lasted there about 3 months. And basically, you know, you get into a situation like that, and coming out, he said, look, the reason I got into this, the reason I accepted a call to that church, is because I wanted to preach the gospel of Jesus, not feed people spiritual baby food. But a lot of us, and a lot of our churches, and a lot of us ministers, we struggle with that temptation. So we have a text today that invites us to take a deeper dive into a bigger meal, multi-course meal. So let's do it. And then discern what's really being taught here, what's being talked about, and what does it mean to take it all seriously? So for starters, maybe you noticed this, but I want to bring our attention to it. Notice how the Pharisees and the Herodians, these church leaders and the state politicians, what do? They come up to Jesus with a bunch of compliments. They start off and they're effusive. Oh, we know how wonderful you are. You're a teacher and a prophet. You show no partiality to anyone. I mean, listen. Someone comes up to you in everyday life and they start talking about that. Are you inclined to trust them? Yeah, exactly. They're either trying to sell you something or convince you of something. So you're wary. Okay, we should be wary when we look at this. But they say all this nice stuff, all this wonderful stuff about Jesus. And then the Herodians and the Pharisees, they spring this trap on him. They think they are. And they say, so do we give taxes to Caesar or not? Now, it helps to know a little bit more about these two groups, okay? As I said, they didn't like each other. The Pharisees thought the Herodians had sold out to the Romans. The Herodians thought the Pharisees were a bunch of uptight religious folk. But neither group liked Jesus, so as I said, they said, all right, he's a mutual friend. Let's band together here. So the Pharisees had managed to carve out a place of privilege and control. In the Roman Empire at that time, Rome would pretty much let you do what you wanted religiously. You could hold on to your customs and you know, maintain your traditions as long as you didn't incite any resurrection or disparage Rome. So however hard that might have been, the Pharisees had managed to do it. Okay, so that was that. But then the Herodians were people who greatly admired a king you've probably heard of, Herod the Great. That's the king who was in place when Jesus was born. Yes, Matthew shares a disturbing detail about Herod slaughtering the innocent children in Bethlehem out of fear. But Herod the Great was also known for a lot of other things, positive things, by the people who revered him. He was seen as a brilliant military strategist, a savvy political leader who was able to navigate a lot of changing tides and times in Judea. So there were still people that liked him, and his sons were in power at the time, so there was some support for him still. And both the Herodians and the Pharisees had their place at the table and their measure of control. They had access, okay? And they liked it. And then here comes Jesus, this popular guy who's got all this support. They a bunch of people say he's a prophet. Even some say he's the Messiah. And they quickly see, the Pharisees and the Herodians, they see, okay, if people start following this guy, we stand to lose. We stand to lose the power and control we have. He's a threat. So they come together in haste and they try to trap him with that question. Do we pay taxes to Caesar or not? What did Jesus say? You hypocrites. This was no meek and mild Jesus here. Any of you had that Warner Solomon portrait of Jesus? This is not that Jesus. This is the Jesus who is not afraid to speak truth to power. He says, you hypocrites. And then he goes on to give them a physical demonstration of their hypocrisy. He says, give me a coin. So they give him a coin. Whose image is on this? And you can almost hear them mumbling, the Herodians and the Pharisees, well, it's Caesar's. And Jesus says the famous line, then give to Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God's. And on the surface level, that does sound like a separation of church and state, doesn't it? But what it really is, what this is really about, is Jesus basically saying to them, all right, who are you giving yourself to? The way of Caesar or the way of love, the way of God? Because you can't do both. And the hypocrisy is seen in the fact that they are standing in the temple, okay, the holiest place in the land. And these Pharisees are the ones who teach the Torah. And in the Torah, it says very clearly, you are not to have any graven images. And yet they're carrying around in their pockets the very graven image of a foreign leader who claims that he is divine. That's why Jesus called them hypocrites. That's why even sellouts. It's no wonder they walk away in silence. You know, the summer before I came here to be your pastor, I was a chaplain at the UCC camp that I grew up attending in New Hampshire. And during one of the evening programs, I decided to give the senior highs there, about 100 plus of them, the opportunity to ask me any question they wanted to. I've done a sermon like this before a couple times where I said, ask me any question, you put it in a hat and I draw it out of the hat and that's the sermon. Well, this time I said, anything about religion or faith or God or church or spirituality, just anything you want to ask me like that. So the first person that stands up is a young woman, 17, 18. Like I said, they're all seniors or so. And she asked me this, or said this. I think the church is a failure. Do you agree or not? And I immediately regretted my decision to open the floor to questions. But I did say, I stayed engaged with her. I said, all right. Tell me more about what you mean when you say that. And she said, my church has been dying, and no one, like dying numbers wise, and no one seems to care. There are hardly any new families there. We don't have a youth group. None of my friends even go to church, and no one seems to care. So what should we do? And I just nodded my head as I listened to this because it resonated so deeply. And I looked around and I tried to find their eyes as I said something along these lines. I said, here's the deal. The church needs you. It needs your strength and energy and youthful insight to remember who it is and to come alive again. To see beyond the doubts and all those stuck places that have held it back. To see beyond the fear and the frailty and the over-focus on numbers and dollars. We need you. But here's the thing. You're going to have to be brave if you're going to step in. Because you're going to need to ask yourself questions like, What am I giving my life to? What's most important to me? And what am I willing to do? What are my gifts, but what am I willing to do? Every single one of us has something we can offer, and every single one of us has something that a growing area, a place that we can really get more honest with ourselves. None of us is perfect, but that's not the point. The point is, if we're willing to be brave, we can change the church, and we can change the world. It reminds me, in many ways, that when Jesus called his disciples, we think of them as these, I don't know how old you think of them, but I think of them as quite young. And when he's starting his ministry, essentially Jesus is starting a youth group. They weren't sure about the future. They didn't know who they were. They were dreamers, maybe, but they were fishing. They struggled with questions and doubts and day-to-day stuff, even finding hope. But as they walked in his way, things started to change. They changed their community and their world. Hey, they even changed the way we keep time. And the church exploded because, I don't know, this youth group or this youth movement got excited and took this word of love, of God's love, out into the streets, out into the world, and it just took off. Now, as a minister, this is the type of stuff that I think about all the time. As a person who's striving to be, you know, congruous in my faith, I try to do this stuff too. What am I giving myself to? That's a tough question. What do I need? Where do I need to be more honest? Where do I need to grow? How can I walk more boldly in the footsteps of Jesus? Not just sing about it, but how can I actually participate in creating the kind of world that's more just, loving, and accepting, like the model he showed us? And on top of that, how do I do that? How do any of us do that in a world, in the face of a world that seems to value less and less the way that Jesus actually walked? Russell Moore, the editor-in-chief of Christianity Today, and the former president of the Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission of the Southern Baptist Convention, so no liberal progressive theologian here, said this within the last year. He's noted how many within evangelical conservative circles now view essential teachings of Jesus, like turn the other cheek from the Sermon on the Mount, as liberal talking points. This is what he said. He says people look at those as weak, ineffectual. And it makes me wonder, maybe, just maybe, the decline of the church has less to do with numbers and attendance and more to do with selling out to power and refusing to stand for the things that Jesus lived and died for. It's always been true, but to walk the walk of Jesus requires courage and bravery every day. You know, I've done a lot of memorial services lately, and one of them I did last month was for a man who served in the U.S. Navy for much of his life. He was part of the Naval Construction Battalion, the Seabees, they call them. And when his family talked about his work, they said, Dad was so proud to serve his country, and he understood that when he was given a command, he followed it. But they also said he lived by a greater command, the great commandment, that had a higher calling on his life. You know, the one that says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's what guided him. That was his highest calling, and that's what he tried to give himself to every day. You know, I don't think Jesus' frustration with the Pharisees and the Herodians and the Sadducees, all the leaders of his day, was really about a church-state issue. I don't think it had much to do with their seat that they had, you know, at the table of political power. I mean, I'm sure he wasn't happy about that. He didn't like it. But I think at the end of the day, what Jesus wants to know more than anything else is, all right, will you then give yourself to the way of love, or will it be the way of power? Can't be both. Will you go in the way of shalom, or will you go in the way of control? and might? Will you serve the way of hope and faith, or will you serve the way of self-centeredness? Because if you say yes to Jesus, which we are here and I think wanting to do, it requires us to be brave, to be willing to face those dichotomies. But the promise, no matter what comes our way, is that God will be with us. And that every step, every movement, every time we give ourselves to the world in the name of love, God's Spirit will be there to strengthen us. So friends, don't let yourselves be trapped. The question that matters, the one that Jesus wants to know, is will you, will I, will all of us go in the way of love? Amen.
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 Spots remaining on December 3rd and 5th, so please check the sign-up sheet in the narthex on your way out. We also, if you didn't miss it, there's the Giving Tree is set up again in the narthex. Already many have been selected, there are a few remaining. Please grab one on your way out, and a reminder, they need to be back next week, December 1st, unwrapped, with the tag affixed to it so we know which child to give it to. We are still continuing our mental health class, even though Gala is on a cruise. Our wonderful Dan will be doing the class at 11:30, and that will be in the chapel. December 7th, 2 weeks away, is our annual Christmas craft fair. It's a huge community event. We would love to have some cookies, Christmas cookies from the congregation for selling. And also, there's lasagna lunch that is being served, but we need helpers for that. So if you're interested, please reach out to Linda Campbell. Also, next week, December 1st, the light parade decorating is happening. Please join us after church. We are going to have cookies, hot chocolate, and Christmas music. And if you missed it on the way in, the church is hosting the Auburn State Theater Christmas Carol again. There will be three shows, one on the 13th at 7 p.m., two shows on the 14th at 2 and 7. Our very own Pastor Dan, this won't be a very big stretch for him, will be playing this part of Ebenezer Scrooge. Kidding. That's all I have for you today. Thank you.
All right, Dan, I'm going to need your help on this one. We're going to turn to 44 in our black Hallelujah Songbook binders. Do you have one?
I do.
And I'm going to have you lead that side as what was previously known as the men's part. And our side will be singing the women's part on page 44, You Are Worthy of My Praise.
Kind of call and response here, and then on the chorus.
Then we come together on the chorus.
Okay. You want me to be the starter, or are you going to start?
You're going to start.
Okay, I'll start.
So, let's stand. Ready? One, two, three, four.
I will worship.
I will worship.
With all of my heart.
With all of my heart.
I will praise you.
Because you looked and you saw all those pictures on those coins and bills, possibly too. Then that is wonderful. Thank you so much for your ongoing generosity. And as Bruce said last week too, you might even have a pledge card. We received a number of pledge cards after last week, after Bruce's very gentle reminder for everyone. But if you had those, please put those in there as well. and anything, a poem, a picture, anything is welcome that reflects something of love given from you. So friends, as we prepare to leave this sanctuary, may the message, may the meaning of the walk with Christ hold us. May we know that bravery is required, but may we find within ourselves and each other the strength to do what is right and what is loving. Go and be servants of the one who shows us the way. Amen.
Amen.
On this day, earth shall ring with the song children sing to the Lord Christ the King, Lord on earth. Save us, in the Father gave us. Ideo, oh, oh, Ideo, oh, oh, Ideo, Gloria, in excelsis Deo.